Well, welcome everyone to our Crossroads Church service stream. As always, we're so glad that you're with us. Thank you for taking the time. We want to encourage you that you can invite some friends and family to watch along with you. People are very open right now to the things of God, and we're going through the Lord's Prayer, and that's a familiar place in Scripture, at least in the hearts and minds of so many people. And so why not encourage them with an invite today? I also want to continue to remind you that you could submit a prayer card through this service and let us know if there's ways that we could be praying for you. And of course, you don't want to miss this. Every Sunday, we have our kids and students webpage that comes up that you could watch lessons that are age appropriate for your children. Just a great way to remain spiritually fed. And so with that said, I want to invite you to enjoy this service. Let the songs that are sung be an encouragement to you. And may this message about taking our needs to God in prayer lift you up right now. And so by God's grace, we're all together here to enjoy it. And so to God be the glory for the blessing that we're going to receive being together. Thank you.
Hi, Crossroads. We're happy to be together again, to gather together to worship our Lord. And we want to wish all our moms out there a very happy Mother's Day. We hope that the Lord blesses you today and that you're able to worship with your family. We're very thankful for all our moms. And we want to, as believers, we want to always keep our minds set on the promised victory of our Lord. You think about, it's mentioned in Isaiah and Revelation, this picture of the elders and the four living creatures, the angels, all sitting around the throne, and they're saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." What a picture that is, what a promise that is, that's our future and that's our hope, that we're going to be sitting around the throne room of the Lord God, and we're going to be worshiping Him for all eternity, all because He has won the victory, and then that victory is ours. So let's praise Him, holding on to that promise, holding on to that truth and the hope of our salvation.
ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Oh, your love is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, yourself to me, and it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will
thankful for the truths that are found in these two songs where you can envision being around the throne of our Lord and our Savior. And I'm thankful that that same Savior never leaves us to try and figure things out on our own. He doesn't leave us to kind of wander about, to face a struggle on our own. He doesn't abandon his children. He doesn't leave us to sit in the fire of our impossible situations. He walks with us. He is always beside us. And he strengthens us and he preserves us. And he holds us in his very, very capable hands. He's the God of all comforts. He comforts us in our afflictions. He doesn't just drop us off here and have us wander about, wondering when or if he's going to show up. He will show up. He will sit with us in our trials and in our temptations. He is Jesus born for our salvation. There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise, things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom.
Who stands in the
Well, welcome everyone to Crossroads once again. We're so glad that you can join our service stream today. Know that we miss you, but we're so glad that we could have a service together like this. And we want to remind you of some very important announcements. As you know, our men's group is meeting weekly on Saturdays. You could email Russ about more information on that, how you could get connected and be a part of that, men. Our women's ministry is also meeting regularly each week on Fridays. And so you could email either Donna or Mary, and they'll be happy to plug you in. And of course, our youth group. If you have children that are of the age of student age and you want them to get connected, you could reach out to my wife, Jen, and she'll be happy to plug you in and get you connected as well. These are all ways just for us to stay, as we mentioned and keep saying, connected to all of this. And just stay plugged in with the app, the church app as well, for notifications. If you haven't opted in yet, the church app is a great way to stay plugged in when we have prayer meetings and we have other gatherings that come up. We don't want you to miss out. We want you to be in the know. Also, I just wanted to just say this, as today is Mother's Day. And normally at this point in the service and even in the message, we ask all mothers to stand up and we give thanks to them. But I just want to let you know, on behalf of Crossroads, that we love all of you moms and grandmoms and godmothers and those who are, maybe you don't have children of the womb, but you are a mother to other people in your family. Thanks be to God for all of you, especially those who have foster children, those who have adopted. You moms are doing God's work. You must realize that the office of mother is without question a blessing, and God is using you, and there's untold blessings waiting for you in heaven for all the laundry, for all the homework you've done, for all the money you've given and everything else in between. And so sometimes being a mom is a thankless job, but not in God's eyes. And so may you be blessed, and we love you, and happy Mother's Day to all our mothers. I also wanted to say that maybe this is a good segue, is for our prayer cards. Go ahead and put your prayer request in. Maybe you want to pray and give thanks to your mom, for your mom today, to God. Whether your mom is with you or she's gone home to heaven, go ahead and submit a prayer card, and you could do that. The link is going to pop up. Go ahead and jot that down or click on it. We'd love to see that. And then, of course, we have our connection card each week. If you're a guest with us watching for the first time or listening, there's a way that you could submit a card to just let us know that you were here. If you need to update your information, a new email, please go ahead and do that. And of course, our Crossroads Care Fund, that's if you want to continue to contribute as we're helping folks in the church and people in the community as far as the first responders are concerned. And then also our Helps page. If you need help or you'd like to give help, you could go to the Crossroads Help page as well, and that's a way for you to let us know if you have any needs that are going on in your family. And then finally, even through all of this, I want to thank you for your faithfulness. I mean, we're going on weeks and weeks and weeks here of not being together in person, and many of you have been so faithful with your giving, and so thank you so much. May God doubly bless you for your faithfulness through all of this, especially those who are out of work right now. Thanks be to God for all of that. And so with that said, you're welcome to give online, whether it be now or later on. But I'm going to give God thanks before we have this next song. Our Father and our God, we thank you for all of our moms. May you bless them today on this special day. Lord, every day is Mother's Day. Thank you for what they do and the sacrifices they make. I pray you'd comfort those who may have lost children, those who may have not had children of their own. And Father God, for those who have said goodbye to mom already and mom is home in heaven, Lord, for some who today is painful, God, I pray your hands of healing would be upon those. But God, we give you thanks nevertheless, oh God, for our moms. Father God, we also ask that you continue to bless our first responders, protect them. Lord, we pray for our city, oh God. We pray, God, for you to beat back this virus and eradicate it. And now as we receive this offering, thank you, oh God, for all that you've blessed us with. Bless the gift and bless the giver. May that which has been sacrificially given over to you be replenished. We sow these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is my prayer in the desert, when all that's within me feels dry. God who provides, who This is my prayer in the fire, in weakness or trial or pain. There is a faith proved of more worth than gold, so refine me, Lord, through the flame. Oh, I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall remain. I will rejoice, I will declare, God is my victory and He is here. Oh, this is my prayer in the battle, when triumph is still on its way. I am a conqueror and co-heir with Christ, so firm on His promise I'll stand. Oh, I will bring praise, I will bring praise. No weapon formed against me shall.
That's our prayer, Lord, that in all seasons, in all circumstances, that there's always something to be thankful for, and that something is You. That something is our salvation, that You laid down Your life so that in every circumstance we can praise You. We can sing Your praises. We can tell of the wonderful things You've done, God, and the wonderful things that You will do, oh Jesus. We're thankful for Your word. We're thankful that we can sit and listen to Your word. We pray that it would direct and drive our lives. Nothing else, God, but You, what You have to say in that word. So speak to us today, God. Wherever we are, Lord, in our homes, in our rooms, driving in our cars, oh God, speak to us like only You can. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Well, hello, everyone. I want to welcome you to our service stream right now. For those who are watching on Facebook and YouTube, our church app and the website. We're so glad that you're with us, and a special welcome as well to those that are listening on AM 570 and FM 102.3. It's always a joy to be with you and share God's word, and we're continuing our teaching series on the Lord's Prayer. And each week we have a principle because we believe that there are seven indispensable principles that you can find in this prayer. It's not a formula, rather it is an ingredients for you and I to have a healthy and strong prayer life. And our principle this week we want to talk about is the cultivation principle. And the cultivation principle says this: when there is a need for prayer in your life, plant the seed. And so when you have a prayer need, plant the seed. And you know, when it comes to planting seeds, there's a lot that's involved with it. Obviously, you got to prepare the ground. You have to put the seed in the ground. You cover it up. You have to fertilize it perhaps, or make sure that it gets the proper rain or sunlight. There's waiting that's involved. And I really think that that captures the understanding of prayer. In fact, this whole idea of planting and agriculture is an example that you can see throughout the Bible. You know, in numerous places, the scripture relates sowing and reaping. That's another way to describe planting, to our finances, to our friendships, and yes, to our faith. We're told not to grow weary with sowing good. In due time, we will reap our harvest. We're also told that if we sow sparingly, we will reap sparingly. But if we sow abundance, we'll reap abundance. And that is especially true with prayer. Even now, when you talk about the portion of the Lord's Prayer that we are up to, we've already talked about how we're to come and call Him Father, that holy is His name, that His will needs to be done in our life as it's happening in heaven, it needs to happen in our own life. And now we get up to probably the most famous part of the prayer, the part when we come to God and ask for our needs. And this is the key verse for our message today in Matthew 6:11. Give us this day our daily bread. And this verse is all about coming to God with our needs. But haven't you felt sometimes that when you talk to God, you feel like maybe you're talking to a wall? I heard the story about a journalist who accepted a job at the Jerusalem Bureau. He took an apartment that overlooked the Wailing Wall. That's the place where people go historically to pray. Now, every day he would look out his window and he noticed that there was this older man that would come there to pray every day. And throughout the day, he would see this man there. And he thought to himself, being a seasoned journalist, maybe I got a story here. And so he went down and he spoke with the man and he asked him, he says, I see you come in to pray here. Is it just by coincidence or do you come every day? And the man was taken back and startled at first, but then he said, yes, I come here every day. And the journalist was really inspired by this man's dedication. And so he then asked him, well, what do you pray for, may I ask? And he says, well, I pray for world peace first. Secondly, I pray for there to be peace among the brotherhood and blessing. And then I go have some tea, and then I come back in the evening, and that's when I pray for God to eradicate all disease and all sickness, especially children who may have been afflicted. And the journalist says, wow, that is incredible that you do that. He goes, well, how long have you been doing this for? And the man says, well, about 20 to 25 years. And the journalist is being more encouraged as he's hearing this. And then he asks the man, he says, how does it feel to come and pray these prayer requests every day? And the man looks back at him and kind of gives a smirk and he says, I feel like I'm talking to a wall, okay? Sometimes that's how we feel. We feel that we're praying and we're consistent. We're praying for righteous things, but we feel like we're talking to a wall. Well, we want to discuss right now in this message on how to talk to God, how to cultivate not only a one-time prayer, but an ongoing prayer life by breaking down verse 11 of the Lord's Prayer. And it's important that we take it in three pieces because we want to know how to sow. Just like if you're going to go to your garden or if you're going to grow something in the house and you have a little plant that you have soil and you're going to throw seed in it, there's a way to sow seed. And so there's a way to sow prayer. And we want to look at three ways to do that. And so let's start off by looking at the first part of Matthew chapter 6, verse 11. And you'll notice this. It starts off with, give us. Now, There's no translation on the planet that starts off verse 11 of the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6 that says, give me. You won't find that anywhere. Lots of different translations of the Bible. It won't say that. Actually, maybe only one translation, our own personal mental translation of this verse. What we have to realize is that like worship, giving, serving, especially praying, it's not about us. See, God wants us to understand that we have to go from give me to give us. That this is a prayer that we're to pray, really, not just for our own needs, but the needs of others. That even as we bring our needs before God, we need to be mindful of the needs of family and friends. That this is a righteous way to pray. This is how you cultivate ongoing prayer in your life. Nothing will sabotage your prayer life quicker than being a selfish prayer person. If the subject of your prayers is always me, 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 well, guess what's going to happen? You're going to short-circuit your prayer life. But if you could develop the habit of praying for other people, yes, in addition to your own needs, perfectly fine, but including others in those petitions on a daily basis, you will greatly strengthen your prayer life. You will cultivate a stronger desire to pray. And a lot of times people go, man, I just can't get out of a rut with praying. Well, the reason why that is because we get so caught up in just what we need. We need to be praying for other people. We need to even be praying for people we don't like and get along with. And so here's a biblical principle that you might want to jot down. When it comes to prayer and sowing, sow prayer with an unselfish heart. Sow prayer with an unselfish heart. That is how God wants us to think. He doesn't want us to get caught up in the selfishness of life, that it's always about me, always about you. We have to pray even when we don't feel like it, even when we think we don't need it. God wants us to be praying, and he especially wants us to be praying for other people. Perhaps one of the greatest examples in the New Testament of that, other than Jesus, is the Apostle Paul. In Philippians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, take notice of how the apostle prayed for the church at Philippi. This is what he said. Take notice of this. I give thanks to my God for every remembrance of you. Verse 4, always praying with joy for all of you in my every prayer. Now, when Paul wrote this, he was not writing this from a beach in a lounge chair and somebody was bringing him a cocktail. No, he was in prison. He was in a special holding area in Rome, most likely chained to somebody else under heavy key and lock and key and watch and so forth and on. And he wrote this thinking of the Philippians, saying, whenever I think of you, I'm praying for you. And no doubt the other churches that he was connected to. He had this others first mentality, and that's how we have to pray. Jesus said, give us, not give me. Give us. That's how we have to be praying, that the petitions that we bring before God should include other people. We should be praying for other people and not just that other people, oh, I pray this happens to them and I pray you get even with them. That's usually the extent of our prayer time for others, but we have to graduate from that. We need to be praying daily for people to be blessed, and we need to do it no matter what. I heard this story about a young boy whose mother was sick with all things as the flu. And so he called the pastor from the church on the corner. So he calls and he asks the secretary if he could speak with the minister. So the pastor comes to the phone and the pastor starts talking with the boy. And he knew the family because it's a small town. And the boy said, could you come to the house to pray for mom? She's sick. And so the pastor said, well, may I ask you a question? I know you belong to the church down the block. He's the church on the corner. He says, why don't you call that pastor up? And the boy said, well, the doctor said mom is contagious and we don't want our pastor to get it. So that's why I called you. The pastor chuckled and thought for a second. And he said, okay, I'll be there. And then a knock came at the door 20 minutes later. And the door is opened by the young boy. And there's the pastor with his own mask and gloves on and says, show me to your mom. I'm here to pray. And so we got to have an unselfish mentality when it comes to prayer. And we need prayer right now in our culture more than ever before. God wants us to be diligent in prayer. And we need to realize, too, that when we have a give us mentality, it sets an example to others. You know, being that today's Mother's Day, I want to, once again, as we said earlier in the announcements, I want to just say happy Mother's Day to all of our mothers. You are doing God's work, taking care of your family. And usually at this point in the service, if we were to be here in person together, we'd ask all of you to stand and embarrass you and clap for you and give you a flower on the way out and some other gift. And obviously we can't do that, but we want to let you know that we thank God for you, especially today. And you can never discount the prayers of a mother, the faithful example of a mother. And we see that in the scriptures as well. A great example that we can look to is in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5. The Apostle Paul commended Timothy, but what he was really doing was commending Timothy's grandmother and Timothy's mother. Look what it says here concerning Paul to Timothy in verse 5 of chapter 1. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, that you have a sincere faith, a faith that dwelt, notice this, first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I'm sure dwells in you as well. See, they were examples for this young man. And God wants us to have that understanding as well, that we need to be people who are leaving an example of faith to others as well. And that example of faith should be prayer. I mean, how many stories have you heard about a praying mom? And that's why we need to be praying. You know, you moms today, maybe all your children don't go to church. Maybe they don't walk with the Lord. You know what? As I've said before, unless you've gotten a note from heaven that said, stop praying, you keep praying. You keep being a Lois. You keep being a Eunice. Look how that impacted Timothy. You never know how it's going to impact your family. Leave that to God. You moms keep being a great example. And I can't think of a better example of being unselfish than a mother. I mean, a mother will go without eating to take care of her children. A mother will go without going to a store to buy a new blouse or a new dress so her kid could have something for school. A mother will drive around and basically be her children's Uber driver now in 2020 if she has to. Moms will always go without so their children can have. And mothers are a great example of being unselfish. And that is how we are to live as well. And just as this grandmother and this mother were a great example to Timothy, we need to be a great example as well. We need to understand that if we're going to sow prayer, we're going to sow it with an unselfish heart. Let's look at the next part of this prayer. So we have give us, so it's not me, give us. And then notice this next part. This day, our daily. And then we'll cut it there. But this day, our daily. And now when you begin to break this down, we have to realize something, that we're to pray, we're addressing God. I say this not in any way to be derogatory towards anybody's background. Now, if you get offended, I don't mean this meanly, but too bad, because it's my job to give you the truth. But when we pray, we're addressing God. We're not going through a Rolodex of saints. Oh, I lost my keys. Let me pray to this person. I have a test coming up. Let me pray to this saint. Oh, I'm going for a drive. Let me pray to this saint. Oh, I'm going to drive with this person. They're a terrible driver. Let me pray to three different saints. Right from the top, give us, that word give, didomai, in the Greek language, is really, it's you and I talking to the supplier. Who's the supplier? God. He's the one that resources us. And so as we're praying, give us, we're praying to God. And now we're asking God, this day, our daily. And so this is passionate. And so when you sow prayer, think of it this way. I'm going to sow prayer daily, dependently, and defiantly. We'll explain all three. But it has to be daily, that we need to be coming before God daily. You know, when we pray to God, we're not just asking God, you know, God, I'm going to pray for you now and just make the rest of my life easy. God doesn't teach us to pray that way. He teaches us to pray just enough for the need of the day. And he taught us that. We're going to see later on in this same chapter, Jesus said, you know what? Go look at the lilies of the field. Look at the sparrow. Look how I take care of the flowers and the animals. How much more valuable are you to me than they are? And your Father knows everything that you need. And he goes on to say, don't worry about tomorrow. Focus on today. Today has enough concerns of its own. In other words, God wants us to pray by the day. Nothing wrong with long-range planning and praying, but really, biblically speaking, we need to be people who are focused on praying for the need of the hour. That's what Jesus teaches us here. A prime example of that is found in the Old Testament. in 1 Kings chapter 17. You might recall Elijah, as God called him into ministry, he was fed by a raven. God said, go here, go to Cherith, and I'm going to feed you. And a raven came and brought him food. And he didn't even question it. You know, I wish a raven would bring me some food, maybe some chocolate bread or cannolis. Well, maybe you shouldn't bring me that. It's unholy. But nevertheless, the raven was bringing him food. But then God called him from there, and God told him to go to Zarephath, and there a widow is going to take care of you. Now, that would sound ridiculous. How's a widow going to take care of me? But hey, a raven just took care of me, so I guess God will make a way. But as he goes there, we know that the brooks have been drying up because he's already proclaimed a drought to King Ahab. And so there's a drought going on right now. And that means that it's affecting the crops. And as he comes to this widow, he asks this widow for something to eat. You know what the widow says? She says, I just have enough resources to cook for me and my young son. We're going to eat and then we're going to drop dead. That's how terrible things are right now. And so Elijah then tells her what to do to make sure you go make the food and not to worry that God is going to provide. And listen to what it says here in chapter 17, verses 15 and 16. So she did as Elijah said. Now, that's a mouthful right there. In other words, this widow, who we already know by reading this story, is hopeless. She feels that she's going to die. That's how terrible things seem to her. And she's thinking, there's no hope right now. But yet, there's something that I believe this woman already has a faith in God, but she's been beaten down by her circumstances. I believe she's heard of who Elijah is, that he's had this showdown on Mount Carmel and all this type of stuff. I believe she's acquainted with some of these biblical facts that we know to be true, but nevertheless, she listens because Elijah is the word of the Lord, so she listens, and then this is what happens. And she and Elijah and her family continued to eat, notice this, for many days. Now, chronologically speaking, for about another year until the rains would come, and then verse 16, there was enough flour and oil, olive oil, left in the containers just as the Lord had promised through Elijah. Now, digging and breaking down the grammatical structure of this verse, what it's telling us is that God, when he blessed them, he didn't give the widow and Elijah a year's worth of bread. No, that's not what happened. They didn't pray. Elijah didn't pray. Nobody prayed, and then poof, there was a year's worth of bread. No, there was just enough oil there to make bread for that day. And then the next day, the next meal, there was more oil that came. That must have been pretty cool saying grace. That's why you got to say grace at your dinner table or at lunch, even if you're out in public. Who cares what people think? Give God thanks. He's going to give you just enough for what you need. And so that's a prime example that we got to pray daily. We got to pray depending on God, trusting that God is going to make a way. You never know how God is going to make a way. I heard the story of a young boy in the inner city who was looking at one of the sneaker stores in town, and he was looking at the glass window at these sneakers that he wanted, but he couldn't afford them. As a matter of fact, he was so poor, his old sneakers had ripped apart, and he just had some wet socks on that he was walking the streets with. Well, he was praying when he was looking in the window, God, let me get a pair of these sneakers. Well, then a woman came and she was walking by, and she herself was a woman of faith, and she had already done her devotions and prayer time in the morning, and she always prayed for God to use her. And so she sees this boy pressed up against the window, and she can notice that he's disturbed as he's looking in the window, and she could see that he's poor just by the way he's dressed. And of course, he has no shoes, and it had already been raining out, and it's cold. And so she says to the young boy, what are you doing? He says, man, I'm looking in the window, and I really would love a pair of sneakers. I'm praying to God for that. And she goes, why don't you come inside with me? And so she goes inside and she asks the manager on duty if she could have some paper towels and if she could have a few of them wet. And she tells the young boy to sit down and she cleans the young boy's feet after he takes off his socks. They were wet, his feet were dirty. And then she says to him, put these socks on after she dried his feet. He puts the socks on. And then she says, I want you to pick out three of your favorite pair of sneakers in this store right now. You can have whatever three you want. And so the boy was overcome with emotion, and he picks out the sneakers, and she goes to the register, and she pays for them, and she notices that he's crying, and she goes, well, why are you crying? And he goes, I'm just so happy. And he says, I have just one question to ask you. And she says, well, ask me anything. What is it? And the little boy says, are you God's wife? And you know, the little boy was overcome by her kindness. You see what happens when you depend on God? He will make a way where there is no way. He will use people in my life and in your life to do incredible things. We just need to stay the course and not give up. Pray daily, pray dependently, and then pray defiantly, we said. You know, there's going to be a lot of naysayers in this life to tell you not to pray, to tell you to give up, that even try to, maybe one day here in America, even sanction rules as to why we can't pray. They already tried to take away, prayer in the school. We know that. And see at the poll, see away from the poll now. But we're going to have to be defiant. And there's a time to be a rebel. And the time to be a rebel is when it comes to your faith, that you want to be rebellious towards evil. You want to be a renegade when it comes to people telling you that you can't pray. Nobody could tell you that. You want to be defiant and you want to pray. Listen, let the governor put prayer down. Let the city council speaker want to throw Samaritan's Purse out of the city because of their warped agenda, because they got an axe to grind with God. But as we said before, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but it is the power of God to those who are being saved. And prayer is the lifeblood of the believer. And you want to be defiant. An example of that in the scriptures is Daniel. Remember Daniel's political, and if you want to call them friends, jealous opponents, they couldn't find anything to stick on Daniel. Over 70 years of great leadership, they couldn't find one scandal. And so what'd they do? They came up with some crony rule that the king signed into order that if anybody prayed to their God and not to the God that they sanctioned, well, guess what? They could be fed to the lions. Well, guess what Daniel did? Did he hide? No. Did he stop praying? No. Look what it says in Daniel 6:10. It says, when Daniel learned that the document had been signed, got back to Daniel, he went into his house. The windows, notice this, in his upstairs room opened toward Jerusalem. And three times, not once, three times a day, he got down on his knees and he prayed. And he gave thanks to his God. Notice this, just as he had done before. My friends, that's defiant prayer. You don't let anybody stop you from praying, because guess who's behind the work stoppage of your prayers? There might be agents of the enemy in this world, but guess who is the ringleader? Guess who's the maestro of evil? The devil. And he wants to get you away from prayer. He doesn't want you and I praying. He wants us decommissioned from prayer. But God wants us to keep on keeping on. We got to be daily. We got to be dependent on God. And we got to be defiant no matter what. So prayer that way. That's how you cultivate prayer. When you have a need, you plant the seed. And if you want God to bring in the harvest, there's going to be times when even your family ridicules you for going to church and praying. By the way, if you're listening to this right now because they got it blasted in the house, you have no choice, or they promise you're going to cook you dinner or something like that, first of all, be thankful you got people in your family that go to church, that pray for you. That person that's in your home, they're sanctifying your home. They're like that grandmother or that mother for Timothy. They're doing their job, and thank God for them, and you need to start doing the same thing, because right now, more than ever, because of COVID-19, life has changed significantly, rapidly, fast, and we need God more than ever before. There's so much conspiracy right now that really some of it sounds true. You know, was it nefarious? Was it gross negligence how this virus came to be? Do we do vaccinations? Do we don't do them? There's lots of controversy out there. And really, our confidence doesn't need to be in Washington or the city council. It needs to be in Almighty God. And so defiant. Prayer. Hey, there might come a day in our lifetime here in America where they put a ban on praying. Well, guess what? We will pray no matter what. We will seek God no matter what. God sits on his throne. His son, Jesus Christ, is seated at his right hand. And that is where our focus firmly needs to be. We will pray daily, dependently, and defiantly. That's how we want to sow, along with having that unselfish heart. And then take notice of this last principle. We want to sow prayer by waiting to reap a rainfall. We want to sow in such a way that we know that God knows our needs and that He is going to provide no matter what. That needs to be the heart of the believer, that we're going to keep sowing and we're trusting God. We're waiting on God. You know, the other day, I was reminded when I saw it in the kitchen. Ben, for school, one of his projects, he had to plant something in the house. And so Jen got this bowl and put some dirt in it, and we had to throw a seed in it. And he did that in the morning. And I remember in the afternoon, he came up to me and he said, "Hey, did it grow yet?" Okay. And he kept asking that all day long and then the next day. And we explained to him, it's going to take a little while. And then sure enough, it started to sprout, and he had a picture that he could send in for his homework. You know, one of the biggest factors in prayer is our ability to be patient and to wait on God. We got to wait on God, and we got to wait on Him to bring the rain, to bring the harvest. See, you can't have a harvest unless there's a rainfall. All the work that a farmer could do, all of the tilling he could do in the field, all of the sowing, everything that goes into it, he still needs the rain. And that, no matter how hard he works, he still needs the rain. That's the same thing with you and I. No matter how hard we labor with prayer, we still need God's favor. We still need God's blessing. It always comes down to that. And as you sow, though, you don't want to sow complaining, going, "Oh, when's this going to happen?" You don't want to sow even with the least bit of contradiction. Well, can, or compromise. Can God do this? No, you want to sow with confidence. God is going to do this. God is going to provide. Because as we referenced earlier, he's promised to provide for His children. Now, we talk a lot about standing on God's promises, but there's something even greater that you and I can do. You can kneel on God's promises. You know, continuing with Elijah, his example, crossing over into 1 Kings chapter 18, there we have Elijah praying and kneeling. And then what happens next? God ends the drought and He brings the rain. Now, out of all the Old Testament prophets, you will see that Elijah gets a lot of mentions in the New Testament. And I think that's for good reason. In the book of James, James' epistle, James says he was a man just like you and I. Because even after these great things happen, we find out that Elijah was so depressed at one point he wanted to die. You could be a great person of faith and go through a storm. What does that mean? You need God to rain on your life. And here, listen to this great story here. There had been a drought for over 3 years. And then Elijah says, picking it up in verse 41 of 1 Kings 18, it says, "Then Elijah said to Ahab, 'Go get something to eat and to drink, and for I hear a mighty rainstorm coming.' So Ahab went to eat and drink, but Elijah climbed to the top of Mount Carmel. He bowed and low to the ground and prayed with his face to his knees." He's kneeling. "And then he said to his servant, 'Go,'" this is what God said, "'go,'" this is what Elijah said to his servant, "'go and look toward the sea.' The servant went and looked and then returned to Elijah and said, 'I don't see anything.' And seven times Elijah told him to go and look. Finally, the seventh time his servant told him, 'I saw a little cloud about the size of a man's hand rising from the sea.' And then Elijah shouted, 'Hurry and go tell Ahab, climb into your chariot, go back to him. And if you don't hurry, the rain will stop you.' And soon the sky was black with clouds, and a heavy wind brought a terrific rainstorm, and Ahab left quickly for Jezreel." Earlier, Elijah said, "I hear some rumbling, I hear the rain coming." Now, I don't think he literally heard the rain. I think he heard God saying, "The rain is coming." Now, if you pray, if you sow with an unselfish heart, if you sow daily, dependently, and diligently, you sow with a humble expectation, waiting on God that it's going to come, you're going to hear God's word very clearly as well. You're going to hear the promises of God as well. But here's the thing, do you believe it? Do you believe that God could provide? You have every reason to believe because of Christ, because of the resurrected Christ. That's how we base all of our prayers. All of the promises that we have in God's word, whether it's a conditional promise that was just for Elijah at this time, or it's other promises in the Bible that we can apply to our life, all of those promises find their yes and their amen in the resurrected Jesus Christ. That is the hope of our faith. That is how we have to think. And if we're going to trust God in whatever season that we're in right now it's a tough one as we're in the valley of the virus. You know, and there's a lot of people right now saying, you know, especially those in government, oh, we're all in the same boat. Well, wait a minute. They're on a cruise ship. You know, we're on a rowboat right now, it feels like. Some of us are hanging on to a raft or some driftwood right now. We're in some rough waters. We're in maybe not just rough waters, and maybe want to look another way. We're in a drought right now, and we need God to send the rain. We need God's favor of healing, even though we have evil people who are leading right now who need Christ themselves. We need to pray for revival. We need to pray for God to send the rain, and the one who can bring it is God Almighty and Jesus Christ. We ask it in Jesus' name, but we have to believe it without a shadow of a doubt. You know, I close with this story. I heard about a defense attorney, a very good one, by the way, who was representing a man. I read this in a book recently, who was representing a man who was on trial for murder. And they had incredible evidence, but they didn't have the body, though. And so the defense attorney figured he'd go for broke. And in his closing arguments, he said, in 60 seconds, the person that this court says is dead, the prosecution says that this person is dead, is going to walk through those doors in 60 seconds. And so the first second went by. You could, by the way, you could hear a pin drop in the courtroom, okay? Also, then followed by some gasps. 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 50 seconds. And as at 58, 59, as they were looking at their watch, and then at 60, guess what? Nobody came through the door. Now, the defense attorney then, in a kind of a patronizing yet conciliatory manner, turned to the jury and said, now, obviously, nobody walked through this door, but each one of you jurors, including everybody in this courtroom, turned and looked at that door. And what that shows is that there's doubt that you think that dead body's really alive and that you were expecting him to walk through the door. I ask you to return a verdict of not guilty. And so then the jury got up after closing arguments finished up, and they went into the juror chambers. They came back in just 5 minutes. And then the lead juror stood up and read the verdict, and he said, we find him guilty. Now, the defense attorney jumped up. He was angry. And he said, how could you find him guilty? All of you, each one of you, I saw you look at the door. You were waiting for him to come in. And so the lead juror stood back up and he said, counselor, may I address you? And the defense attorney said, yes, what do you got to say? And he says, well, we not only looked at that door, but we looked at you and we looked at the person you're defending. And neither one of you looked at that door. And if you didn't look at that door, then you believe and you know that that man is dead. And that is why we have returned that verdict. See, here's the principle, that you need to believe. And if you don't have the conviction to believe, well, guess what? Nobody else is going to believe either. But guess what? Then how is there going to be a rainfall here? How is there going to be a rainfall in your life if you don't believe? And really, our life is a witness to everybody else. Your prayer life, not just by verbally how you pray, oh, look how this person prays, look how they pray, but really your ability to remain calm in a tough spot, your ability to remain faithful to God is a witness to everybody else. And you show people that you truly believe that Jesus Christ is every bit of who he said he is when you believe that God could bring the rain in your life. And God wants to bring the rain in your life. He wants to rain down blessing and favor and miracle and healing and opportunities and breakthrough and spiritual growth. He wants to rain down salvation in your family. He wants to rain down addictions to be broken. He wants to rain down that grace from his throne, his merciful throne. And it's all made possible because of Jesus Christ. And so when Jesus says, pray, give us this day our daily bread. What is your daily needs right now? What are the needs of others? Bring them before God, our supplier, our resource. With an unselfish heart, daily, dependently, defiantly, even when others tell you no, even when your flesh tells you no, and pray, so expecting, waiting to reap a rainfall that will produce a harvest of blessing. That is how God wants us to pray. That is how Jesus instructed us. Give us, oh Father, give us our family, our friends, God, bring salvation, bring healing. Right now, pray this over our city. Lord, give us a reprieve, oh God. Lord, we confess our sins to you, oh God. We need you more than ever. Let that be said of us. And let us, without a shadow of a doubt, trust that if we pray in Jesus' name, as Jesus taught us to pray, we're asking for these needs in Jesus' name. The Son of God, who died for my sins and your sins, who made peace with God on the cross, and now gives us the opportunity to pray and have this peace. My friends, like Elijah, you're going to be able to say, I hear the rain coming. God is sending the rainfall your way and to your life. You stay in faith. You keep trusting in God. And don't just stand on his promises. Like Daniel, like Elijah, and like the Lord, you kneel on the promises of God. Remember, when you're on your knees, you're not weak. You're just getting stronger. So glory be to God for all the rain he's brought before. And thanks be to God for the rain that's going to fall. We ask you now, in all that we've shared today, that don't give up, don't lose hope. Keep your eyes fixed on the Lord. Remember this prayer. Pray it every day, Lord. Give us, Lord, this day our daily bread. And let's rejoice in advance to the blessings that are going to come. I pray that you have received these blessings today from God's word. Let's pray together. With all of our heads bowed and eyes closed, I want to just pray over you right now. Our Father and our God, I pray for everybody that's watching and listening right now. Lord, we present our needs before you. Lord, give us strength, even when we don't feel like praying, even when we want to throw the towel in. Help us, oh God, give us this day our daily bread principle. Lord, we want to cultivate a strong prayer life. When we have a need, Lord, we want to plant a seed this way. Go before us, oh God. We commit these prayers. We sow these prayers. And in faith, looking to reap a rainfall and a harvest of your blessing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise, things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation. We'll be right back.
God bless you.
Well, thank you so much for spending your Sunday, especially today on Mother's Day, with us. Once again, happy Mother's Day to all of our mothers. We love you. We pray that today's service was an encouragement to you. I want to remind you to stay connected through the week. We have our daily devotion that comes out every morning right to your email. If you'd like to subscribe, you could do that. It's also on the church app, and you can find and access it on social media as well. If you haven't already, go ahead and like our Facebook page. That's a great way to get connected. And our YouTube channel, you could subscribe to that as well. And Twitter, Instagram, these are all ways to be plugged in. And really a great way to share your faith with friends and family. And so take advantage of those platforms. There are those behind the scenes who diligently work hard to keep that information relevant and sharp and provide content. And so go ahead and really use that to your advantage. I want to remind you of that. And as well as our daily video devotion comes out every day. And so these are just all ways that we've decided that through COVID-19, we want to remain focused on our purpose. And our purpose is to share God's word, the hope of heaven with you, to encourage you and for you to share that with others. And so we're putting that before you. And as we tell you each week, we have our children's page. If you're just watching for the first time, we have a kids and students section where you can get age-appropriate lessons. Even if you didn't get to do it earlier today, you can go ahead and do it now after the service. It'll remain up there. In fact, you could even go and look in our app and find the previous weeks of the children's lessons. It's so important that our kids, our children, are getting the word of God as well, in addition to the message. And so we encourage you with that. And then, of course, we keep reminding you, prayer request, prayer request, prayer request. Submit a prayer request. Not even just during the service, but through the week. Take that link, copy it down. We got to be in prayer for each other. And so once again, thank you for being with us another Sunday. We're praying for you. We're trusting God. We're waiting on Him. And no matter what the next steps may be, no matter what protocols may have to be put in place, our trust is in the Lord God Almighty. God bless you.